Open Brave Words Radio.
Welcome back to Brave Words Radio. Brought to you by Vox Protocol, the global leader in voice app entertainment. Brave Words Radio is an awesome musical extension of BraveWords.com, where we have been waving the flag of hard rock and heavy metal around the world for over 30 years. Since you have been here before, we hope you enjoy Brave Words Radio.
Please welcome to Brave Words Streaming for Vengeance, a longtime friend, Mr. David Ellefson. How are you doing?
What's going on, Tim? How are you, buddy?
You know what? There's been a lot of holy water that's gone under the bridge since you last held wedding rings in Fort Lauderdale.
Hopefully it's not holy hell. What was that? Hopefully it's happily ever after and all is well.
But it seems like a lifetime ago that we were doing all that, and so much has gone on, COVID and all this other stuff. But can I start on just a quick comment about Tina Turner from you?
Yeah. You know, thank you for asking. You know, here's a funny story. So her husband, Irwin Bach, who I saw was mentioned in the story yesterday that went out on the newswire. They were boyfriend, girlfriend. They then married. He was a maybe president or vice president of EMI Germany back in the 90s and during the big Megadeth year. So one day he picks me and Dave up at a hotel in Germany and takes us up to the Nuremberg racetrack. And along the way, and it's funny because he's in one of, you know, these tall Mercedes vans are very popular now. They're very yuppie and popular, right? But he was the only one who had one that I knew of. And he's talking about how they were really tall because of the soldiers with their helmets. This is what they were designed for. And he had one because obviously he had the means. And so he says on the way to the track, he goes, "Hey, I got to stop into the house real quick and get something." And we pull up and I realize this is where he and Tina Turner live, right? Wow. And we're like, holy shit, like Tina Turner's inside the house. Now, he didn't invite us in, but, you know, but yeah, close. it was that moment. And Irwin is a wonderful man. And it was just, so that's kind of my brush with Tina Turner. You know, it was at least sitting outside in the driveway of her house, you know, while her, you know, while her man went in to get, I don't know, some tickets to the race or cell phone or whatever, you know. So, but then we went up to the race and, you know, got to go to the Nuremberg racetrack, and then, you know, life carried on. But so that's my Tina Turner story.
It really hit the world hard, though.
You know, what's so interesting with her, I was reading that whole story yesterday, and I don't know if it's kind of that main, but it's very biographical. It really tells the journey. I mean, obviously, the whole history with Ike and her is of legend, and like Larry King, I guess, was quoted in the article, you know, really pointing out she was kind of one of the, I guess feminist, but like leaders of, you know, coming out from under such abuse, you know, and this kind of stuff. And she just kind of got on with life, you know. She was obviously extremely talented. You know, I think probably for you and me, being of our age, you know, the 80s MTV era was this total reinvention for her.
Absolutely.
And, you know, fellow Canadian with Bryan Adams, that song was great. Thunderdome. Yeah, you know, I mean, her, you know, she had great songs. And, you know, went head-to-head and toe-to-toe with the Stones and the Biggest of the Big, you know. So it's really a wonderful success story. And, you know, it certainly was not a wasted life, you know. So as sad as we are that she's gone, I mean, boy, you know, she hit it hard and left us with something pretty special.
Now let's take a 180-degree turn and talk about this project. With Entombed is arguably one of my favorite bands of all time. Like, I listen to who as much Entombed as I do Slayer or Megadeth, but I know it's Entombed AD and Decapitated. So it's pretty extreme lads that you united with on this project. Yeah. And what's the proper spelling? I've heard it pronounced Dieth, Death, a number of ways. Please,
you can call us whatever you want, but we call ourselves Dieth.
Okay.
In fact, that's our new hashtag. We are Dieth, which, of course, unless you hear it pronounced, you know, You can't tell, but you know, it's funny well, first of all, I respect your musical opinion, and you know, even just based on your t-shirt alone. Yeah, you know, it's funny thing is, the heavier the music, the nicer the guys. Just a fact, right? It's almost like, you know, the guys that go to the gym and blow it out, they're like the sweetest, nicest guys after the gym because they, you know, they just, you know, pounded the hell out of it. But same goes with music, you know. So it's as scary and dark and heavy as a lot of this metal is that we listen to. Super cool guys. I think here's the thing about this, you know. What a random meeting, as you know, the good Lord, the universe, however you, whoever it is you sort of point to, that would grab a, you know, a Brazilian, a Polish man, and a U.S. guy and put us in the same band, completely unforeseen. I mean, none of us saw this one come, right? Out of everything that could come down the pike. And this is in January 2022. So again, new year, new month, new day, new music for the three of us, kind of a, well, not kind of, for sure, a big musical reset. And right, the fact that, you know, we all had a desire to do something. And, you know, just by way of a random email introduction for me, from my buddy Christian from Dead by Wednesday, you know, sends the email. And next thing I'm in the studio, and then I'm in Poland shooting a video. And next thing, Napalm's knocking on our door. And here we are, you know, a year later talking about a record. So a pretty quick timeline, all things considered.
Now, the early 80s spawned Speed and Thrash. You were in one of these major bands. And those bands, like Megadeth and Slayer, helped nurture the whole black and death metal movement. So, but there's a lot of bands from that era that can't handle the Cookie Monster vocals, know what I mean? But
yeah,
you seem to love the extreme.
Well, you know, it's funny. You're right. I was in an extreme band in 1983, you know, when we started Megadeth. That was very, very extreme. The name was extreme, you know, and I called home and my parents were like, hey, what are you doing out in California? How's music school going? I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm not going to that music school. I met a guy, my neighbor, and we started a band called Megadeth, you know. And because, you know, back in that day, Megadeth was like one heavier than Black Sabbath, which is as dark as it got. You know, I mean, Black Sabbath just ruled in doom and dominion, you know, more than all. And Megadeth was like one heavier. And, you know, it was daunting and dark and heavy. And, you know, as you can hear on those, especially the 80s Megadeth, you know. Fast, loud, and rude. I mean, everything about our mission statement, you know, was that. It was extreme in the lifestyle, everything about it. So, yeah, I've been here before. And, you know, look, I've done other things. I've done F5. I've done the Lucid. I've done various things that aren't as extreme, and they're fun, too, because I'm a fan of Cheap Trick and Kiss and, you know, other stuff. And but, you know, what it seems to kind of always come back to that seems authentic and what my fans seem to gravitate toward me doing is this, you know, Megadeth, Dieth, even when I worked with Max Cavalera, you know, that got big thumbs up, you know, when I worked with Soulfly just because of that stuff. So, you know, this seems to be a common thread in my life. And I think what I like about this too is, you know, Guilherme has a very listenable voice, because I call it Cookie Monster too when it's just kind of, I mean, you hear some of them and it sounds like the dog barking out back, and I just don't understand it. And I'm a guy gravitated toward melody. I grew up with 70s hard rock and then into the 80s when it was my turn. I've always gravitated toward something of melody and at least discernible words. Words are hard to write. Telling stories in a lyric is not easy. So if you go to all that work, I'd rather people understand it for me personally.
Right.
And then, you know, me becoming one of the singers, again, unforeseen until we were working on putting the album together. And really, it was Guilherme and Michal who said, you're singing, you know, and they sort of held my feet to the fire on it, which I was happy about. I've been a singer in bands before, so I'm fine with it. And, you know, I just find it funny that my very first band when I was 12 years old, it was a three-piece band, and I was one of the singers, and now here I am at 58, I'm in a three-piece band, I'm one of the singers. So it's kind of the bookends of my life here.
Now, arguably, Megadeth, not to keep bringing Megadeth up, were probably the most technical of the big four, and this band is quite, like, you listen to, like, the last couple of Decapitated records, it's like Meshuggah times 10. Like, it's that that technical. So you're back to technical.
Well, I am, and it's funny because when we were in the room rehearsing back in April, I was over there to shoot the music video that we're putting out next week for the song Walk With Me Forever, which is the ballad, if you will. But it's funny, we got in the room and we were rehearsing, and, you know, we're finding our own way. And we all have our past history and our past experiences. And, you know, one of the things that it just seems so, because the band is organic, I mean, you really feel this is dudes in a room playing, you know, there's not a lot of Pro Tool. We didn't put everything to a grid, and we didn't do it. It didn't seem like the right thing to do. It seems very, you can kind of feel the pushes and pulls and the very organic stuff in the music. So as we're rehearsing it now, you know, I said the same thing because, you know, Michal would always sort of refer back to Decapitated, how just regimented and just, you know, almost like a computer, everything was just had to be this perfect thing. Right. And I've been down that road myself. And I was like, you know what? Why do we do this to ourselves? We're not computers. We're not machines. We're human beings. This is what makes it relatable to people. This is what people come to see live music. We don't go to watch computers. We go to watch humans. Let's be human, you know, right. And be able to make these songs, you know, a song like Free Us All, we can expand it. It doesn't have to be so literal like it is on the record. We can open up sections to be a little more jammy. I mean, it already has this kind of 70s Allman Brothers thing in it anyway. I'm like, why not do what they do? They didn't give a fuck. They take songs and play for 15 minutes, you know? Yeah, right. And I just saw a guy that was at the Grateful Dead concert the other night here in town, or the Dead, or whatever they call it now. And it's like the same thing, you know? It's like, that's why the places are packed, because it's just this kind of free form. So it's funny that the band, as it's transitioning now onto the stage, there's an element of that is a little more loose and organic. Soulfly was like that, you know? And so I like that, you know? And I think part of it is because we're not bookended with two guitars, you know? Because when you're two guitars, the more people in the orchestra, the more everybody has to kind of know when we're stopping and starting and what we're doing. And right. With three people, and even with an additional hired musician to play guitar for us on tour, we could kind of be a little more freeform with it. And honestly, I think it's super fun, man. I mean, that's a really cool kind of liberating new chapter for us.
Now, I look at, I'm a huge collector, and I look at all what's available these days. And what do you think about the vinyl craze?
Honestly, I think it's bullshit. You know, vinyl sounded like shit back when you used to have to listen to it. It doesn't, I mean, look, it sounds better now. And of course, look, now, you know, I went to Best Buy for something, which is one of our electronic stores here in town, right? And the guy takes me back, I was looking at some vinyl, he takes me back, he puts on the Adele record. And I mean, it's this $100,000, you know, system, Macintosh, just, of course it sounds amazing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And there's people that are really into this, you know, lawyers and executives who, I don't want to throw $100,000 at a stereo. I'll throw $100,000 at a PA system for me to play live, but not for me, not to sit around and listen to music. I mean, honestly, these earbuds is how I listen to music. And usually on an airplane, I mean, I've got nicer, you know, Bose noise canceling for flying, but you know, that's how most of my music listening is on an airplane, or it's in my car. It's when I'm just not having to, you know, do other stuff. But I love digital, and I was glad when it showed up. And I mean, look, I could hear it. Yes, 90125, whatever. yeah. Like, that was the first record that I heard on CD back in, what, 84 or whatever.
Yeah.
And I could hear it. Yeah, the blow end was a little thin, you know. It had that. But I mean, there was so much other great stuff that I heard in it. I was just having this, you know, discussion with recording the other day, and but you know what, Pro Tools HD is fucking great. It sounds as good as analog to me. You can playlist. I love making records in digital because you can just you can create more. You can playlist ideas. You can put things down, especially if you're writing and maybe you don't have a vocal melody and stuff together yet. You know, as a writing tool, digital is so much better, I think personally. And you know, and as an end user, I mean, here's what I do. And you'll appreciate this, because that the last vinyl I just bought was a Bachman Turner Overdrive, Not Fragile album. I bought it for $10 on Amazon, right? And it's old. And again, that was the first record that ever got me into all this shit. It's the whole reason you and me are even having a conversation all these years later. It's from that BTO Nut Fragile record. And I used to listen to it on 8-track because we had a farmhand that had it. I'd ride with him in the tractor just so I could hear it, you know, every day. But I buy it on iTunes because I buy everything. And I'm subscribed to Apple Music because they pay us a lot better than Spotify. So I subscribe to Steve Jobs' idea. So I every record that comes out, I buy it, including my own. I always buy one of my own to contribute to the cause, you know. Like the Dieth record, I already did the pre-order. I'm waiting for it to show up next week.
Cool.
And then sometimes what I'll do is I'll buy BTO Not Fragile. So I have it in my ears on my phone when I'm traveling. But then, you know, I'll buy the old, and not a new one, an old one, intentionally an old version of it, that like the gatefold, because I want to see the pictures, I want to read the credits. Because part of that vinyl experience for me is going back, you know, 40 years, 45 years, and going, oh my God, I remember the experience that I had when I opened this up. You could smell the, you know, the prints, and just looking at the pictures, these guys are larger than life. You open it up, it says Mercury Records, it's got all the credits. And even last week when it showed up from Amazon to my house, I opened it up, and even though it's old and beat up and scratched, I had that same experience. I'm like, God, that's right. Check this out.
Do you know what where they got the name Not Fragile from?
I don't. Let's fill me in.
Apparently, it's to take the piss out of Yes's Fragile record, apparently.
Well,
Randy Bachman said, well, we are not fragile. Isn't that awesome?
I love that. And again, I'm a huge Yes fan.
Yeah.
But there is this nerdy, pretentious thing about prog music. You know, and I've now offended all prog musicians, and I don't mean to, because I am kind of a prog musician myself. But I mean, look, if we can't, yeah, if we can't laugh at ourselves, then, you know, we should fuck off. So, you know, so here it is, right? So I love that, man, because, I mean, I listen to that record. The tones are so good. The low end is huge. I mean, it's part of the Sound City. I think they mixed it there in Sound City. And, of course, that console, you know, that movie that Grohl did, on that. And I never got to work there. I never did a record there. But it was, you know, it's obviously a legend. And there is a sound, man. I mean, Cheap Trick, you know, Heaven Tonight, the Fleetwood Mac stuff. I mean, there's a low end. And some of that's in mastering. And who knows how they recorded it and everything. But I will say this: as soon as I heard that bass, flat wound strings, sounds like with a pick. I mean, that just defined what I was going to do with the rest of my life. And I think I was 10 years old when I heard that.
That's amazing. Yeah. Do you remember your first vinyl? Was that your first vinyl?
You know, I remember my friend John had that, and I'd go to his house and listen to it. I didn't own it. I think, again, our farmhand had it on 8-track. I think I bought it on cassette. My parents had bought a Wurlitzer organ, which was my first musical experience, is learning the organ, and it had a cassette player in it, you know? So they had, like, Staller Brothers and Charlie Pride and all this country stuff, so I, you know, I infiltrated it with Not Fragile. So I, you know, for vinyl, I think the first vinyl I ever bought was for a friend of mine. It was his birthday, so I bought him Led Zeppelin Presents. Right next to it was Kiss Alive, going, I'd buy that for him, but I'm going to buy that for me one day, you know? Yeah, so right. I don't want him to have my, that's for me, that's mine, you know? But I can't even remember what my first vinyl was. And, you know, in America, we had the Columbia House record and tape club, right? Where, you know, for one penny you'd buy 13 records, right? And they were the shitty, like, third and fourth generation. So unlike my BTO record, there were, you know, there's no sleeve that has all the, you know, the lyrics, and like, now it's just a white sleeve. It's some cheap pressing, which sounded like shit, which probably didn't help my vinyl experience, you know? That's why I kind of, you know, here's the other thing about vinyl. If you remember, it's all about, you know, your Marantz turntable, your freaking huge tower speakers. So about the time you really get vinyl rocking, so that, you know, at some keg party, it's kicking your ass. Now it's so loud that it skips the fucking needle over the vinyl. So, I mean,
You can't win.
The whole thing is just wrong. You can't win. It's all wrong.
Do you have time for a couple more questions?
I do, yeah.
Awesome. Sadly enough, there was the 7th anniversary of the death of Nick Menza within the past week.
Right.
And you're working on this wonderful project. Tell me about what do you miss from him, and what's going on with this thing? When are we going to see the light of day?
Well, so, you know, it's interesting about that is his son Nicholas actually got married on that same day. I forgot if it was Saturday or Sunday, whatever it was. So his son Nicholas actually got married on the 7th anniversary on that same day, which I thought was very super cool.
Okay.
I didn't want to make mention of it because that's for the family to, you know, talk about that. But yeah, I put a little post up about it because, you know, Nick is just one of those guys that when you think about him, you just, your heart warms and you get a smile and you just, you know, there's so many great anecdotes throughout the film of people who are interviewed in it. And everybody says the same thing about what a wonderful guy he was. He was very much a family guy. He was all about his friends. When he got behind that kit, we all know who that guy is, larger than life. I mean, he was basically the Tommy Lee of thrash metal. You know, he was bold, and yet he was a very heartfelt guy. You know, I don't know if that's sort of his Italian heritage or whatever, but, you know, and it's funny because, you know, his dad, Don, who was a very esteemed woodwind player, I was over at their house about a year and a half ago when we were interviewing the family for the film, and he still goes, he's 80 years old, still goes upstairs, practices every day, and listens to music. Probably vinyl, for sure, right? Like, listens to vinyl. And, I mean, he is a dyed-in-the-wool, forever musician, truly a fan, a student of music at 80 years old. And, I mean, this guy has played on Madonna records. He's the guy who played Pink Panther for Mancini. I mean, he's like that guy, right? And right. So you know, the funny thing with Nick, and we talked about this one time, and he even said it in his book, you know, that because his dad was a jazz musician, Nick's rebellious nature was, well, yeah, then I'll go be a rock and roll musician. And he even said in his book, if my dad was a rock musician, I would have become a jazz musician, you know? Just to like, you know, that's how he is, how he was.
Now, you said the word thrash, Kings of Thrash. Are we going to see it being brought up to Canada or at least outside of the States? And are we going to see a record?
You know, I hope so on the tour dates. You know, it's I think as people have seen it, they've experienced it, they love it. It really sounds good. it's done from a place of just triumph and celebration for the catalog. You know, we're not a tribute band because two of us were in the band, so it's not so much a tribute. Yeah, right. It's more of a, I kind of look at it more like Roger Waters out doing, you know, his take on his own music from his own catalog, you know? And of course these songs are not played in the current, you know, Megadeth set list, haven't been for many, many years. And you know, look, there's a special touch to these things too, because, you know, look, these songs were written, especially Killing Is My Business. You know, we were a up and coming band playing clubs in smaller places. That's where this music works. It doesn't work in the arenas. It just doesn't. So, yeah, look, I would love to get up to Canada. You know, it seems like it's kind of one tour at a time. We do one and we finish it and we go, well, now what are we going to do? And the next thing the phone rings and like, now we're going to Australia in July.
Right.
And we have some material that we've been working on. We Jeff and I, really how we, you know, back to the Nick Menza thing, Jeff helped us get a studio in LA back in January 2022 to kind of host the filming of a lot of the participants in the film. As a result, that led to me and Jeff a month or so later going into the studio and writing four new tunes. We took one of them onto the stage, Bridges Burned, during the tour that we did, the Kings of Thrash tour. And so we've since gone in the studio to just kind of work with it as a group now and start to get some parts laid down. So there will be something here at some point. Obviously my focus now is Dieth and with everything going on with that. And then as far as, look, the movie, you know, the Nick Menza movie, back to that thing too, you know, that's being edited now. I finished the narration. I did that a week or two ago. got that all done. Because that was originally what I was hired for, which is, hey, would you narrate the film? And in my usual nature, I'm like, let's call this guy and let's do that. Let's bring everybody together. And, you know, I'm kind of that guy that sort of keeps my arms around the family, you know, to sort of keep the legacy alive. So, you know, once it's done, then there's the trips around to the film festivals and getting the distributor and then releasing it. So could be this year. My feeling is more likely it's a 2024 thing. And then, yeah, as far as Kings of Thrash music, we'll see where that's at after the summer and figure it out from there.
If I may boldly ask, where do things lie with Mr. Mustaine?
Well, I haven't talked to him in 2 years, so that's where it's at, you know? So, you know, hey, look, you know, like I said, I wish you well, you know?
Yeah.
Have happy trails, you know? And, look, I knew when things suddenly and abruptly ended in 2002, out of nowhere, once that happened to me once, I you know, look, fool me once, shame on me, or shame on you, fool me twice, shame on me, right? So I learned when I went back that, you know, I'm not going to put all my eggs back in one basket. As much as I was 100% committed to it when I went back, you know, history shows, you know, keep your eye on your life raft in case you got to get off the boat and, you know, head safely back to shore, you know what I mean? So that's why I kept doing a lot of other stuff. And I never tried to trump the brand or, you know, or do any of that kind of stuff. But, you know, as a result, I certainly got a lot of kudos for, you know, the record label and the coffee company and doing these other things. And, you know, now I'm in a phase where I'm liking doing music and just really being focused on that. And, you know, as the universe does, it sort of brings you the next thing, like Dieth. I mean, again, completely unforeseen, about 6 months out of Megadeth, it was like, this landed in my lap after I, you know, put out the Lucid record, which I really liked because, you know, those are good dudes. And I think we made some really good, songs with that record. But then this Dieth thing landing in my lap was just kind of like, yeah, this is pretty freaking cool. So, and I think it kind of keeps me connected back to the, you know, to the real heavy wheelhouse as well, which I think the fans are happy to see me doing.
Just two more for you. When I was reading Noel Monk's book, Managing Van Halen, I felt really bad for Michael Anthony, who got cut out of the pie. Do you remember when Mustaine, like, took over everything? Was there a point when, like, even with Iron Maiden, Paul Di'Anno's making no royalties right now. He got the check,
right,
that's
right.
It. Right. Do you remember the time when Dave just said, okay, this is my beast, you're going to get paid?
Well, look, the breaking up of the band in 2002 was 100% that initiative, right? Break it up, take it all back, you know. So that's why we had such an ugly falling out and lawsuit, was me fighting for my own. Look, I still get paid my royalties. I'm not broke, you know. I made sure that I got my, you know, my share of it. But, you know, and at some point when 2 years later I get the call, hey, I'm putting in, you know, I'm ready to get going. It was like, well, he wasn't ready to get going with Megadeth as it was. He tried to do a solo thing, which everybody pushed back on and said, hey, we didn't sign Mustaine. We signed Megadeth. You know, these contracts say Megadeth. And I think at that point, people just wanted to get their money back and get the contract completed. So as much as they would have loved for me to be there and other members, I think at some point they're like, you know, let's just get this out the door. And, you know, and I speak partly to Sanctuary Records, you know, who, you know, had the album deal there. So look, you know, as loyalties in our business go, you know, it's sort of at some point it's like, look, we just need a record that says Megadeth on it. Let's get this done. And, you know, look, that deal was then done after that and life moved on. You know, at the same time, people were certainly happy when I came back in 2010 because, you know, you know, the bass player at that time was being fired and, you know, a falling out there. So, and quite honestly, Sean Drover knew there's only one guy to come back and play Rust in Peace. And of course, that's me. And that stuff came back to me very easy. I kind of stayed up on the catalog. And honestly, Tim, I agreed to go back for 1 month and I almost didn't want to do it. I was just like, look, I've been down this road before. I know where, you know, the hand grenades lie in this battlefield. And, but, you know, look, he talked me into it and Dave was very gracious to me. You know, he was very gracious to me when I came back. He was very generous he was very thankful, and it was a nice way to reconnect. And I was just kind of like, well, if nothing else, we'll tour for a month, and if nothing else, we'll end as friends and we'll leave it there. And it was successful. We had a good time, and you know, we decided to carry on. Go to South America. Okay, I guess we'll go to Europe, do the big four. You know, it was kind of one tour at a time, and right. You know, cautiously move forward. And then we made the 13 record, and you're in the studio, and you know, on I went for another 11 years. So, you know, and I understood, look, the rules of it were different, and I understood that, you know, which is why I was active on the side doing all my other stuff, because I had every right to. And again, I was always very cautious and respectful toward, again, don't trump the brand, you know, don't get bigger than the brand, you know, that's kind of part of this stuff is do stuff on the side, but, you know, keep it in its bucket, keep it in its lane. But I don't know, I guess at one point I maybe got too famous for doing that. So.
But you're like in such a wonderful position in life right now, because Ellefson is a brand. And what does it feel like to wake up and you really can do whatever the hell you want?
You know, well, thank you for that. And yeah, some days I wake up and I go, why am I even doing music anymore? I already did all this, you know? And it's a very different world. It's a much harder world without the sort of hope and promise and glimmer of, you know, a big day one day down the road. Because let's face it, unless we got in the game many years ago and got in under the wire, those days really don't exist anymore, at least not for heavy metal. And there's some bands, of course, that are get to experience it, you know? But you know, I've had that big day for me. So I think for me, I try to just be involved in things that, first of all, I enjoy them. I like being around the people, because I'm certainly not going to fight these ugly battles anymore. And I'm not going to be in bands with people that are troublesome and just constantly a pain in the ass. It's like, why, you know, why I already did that, you know, why do that again? And you know, so, you know, liking the music, liking the people, that's really kind of the thing, you know, for me. And you know, on some days I wake up and I come in this office and go, yeah, fuck this. I'm going to go play golf or jump in the swimming pool and just goof off and sit around and watch Netflix and just not do music. You know, I mean, there are days now that you know, again, look, I'm coming up on 60 and not like there's a hard number of retirement. I mean, look, if you're a musician, you never retire. You always play music.
Right.
I mean, that's just how we are. You know, it just calls to us, you know. So, you know, to me, the numbers of your life really don't mean that much. It's more just kind of a feeling. And, you know, but, you know, the funny thing is, I mean, look, I was in the studio last week. I'm going over to Europe next week. We're rehearsing. We're touring. I mean, so I don't know, you know, one day at a time, man. I think, you know, the good Lord sort of, he gives you the marching orders, you know, give me this day my daily bread, as the saying goes, as the prayer goes, you know.
And always remember, it's a good day when you wake up.
Well, that's just it, right? I mean, look, you realize, I remember a doctor told me that, he goes, let's face it, you're not going to double your years. And that was the sobering reality. I don't know, that was around age 45. Right. So that was, you know, 13 years ago for me. He goes, you're probably not going to double your years. And going, and that's kind of like, God, I never thought of it like that, you know. And then now as the time goes on, I mean, look, I take care of myself. I feel great. I'm healthy. But, you know, yeah, look, none of us get out of here alive. We're all going to leave the planet. And look, I'm not afraid to die. No. Well, the dying part I'm not looking forward to, but I'm certainly not afraid of being dead, you know. And, you know, I think, you know, my feeling is, you know, and you're not afraid of dying, you're not afraid of living either. So, you know, just that's, I think, probably my biggest motivation is instead of asking why, I always ask, why not? You know, what do we got to lose? You know, if you say no, you know what you got. It's right here.
Yeah.
If you say yes, you're like, well, it could be scary. It could be a little, you know, unnerving, out of your comfort zone. But it's like, yeah, fuck it. Roll the dice. Let's go. You know, and that really has been my, since 2002. And those were some words, again, I've credited my friend Al Petrelli for giving me that advice. And he's right. It really is. It's such a big, not only just as a professional musician to say yes to gigs and that stuff, but just in life, it's just like, why not? Let's go.
Thank you for the music. Thanks for everything you've done for Brave Words, and thanks for everything you've done for me. I really appreciate it, man. It's such a pleasure to see you and talk to you. Okay?
You're welcome, Tim. Okay. Good to talk to you, buddy.
Okay.
See ya.
Take care, man. Okay, bye-bye.